Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the sixth meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee. Apologies for the brief delay to the commencement of proceedings this morning. Before we begin, can I remind everyone that social distancing measures are in place across the Holyrood campus. At agenda item one today, we have consideration of whether to take agenda item three in private. Are we agreed? Yes, we are agreed. Thank you very much. As part of the committee's main business today, we have two evidence sessions. During the first session, we will hear from the Scottish National Investment Bank. This session is an opportunity for the committee to discuss the bank's approach to net zero and its investment priorities across a range of areas. I welcome this morning Willie Watt, Chair of the Bank, and Ailey McTaggart, Chief Executive. Thank you very much both for taking time out of your busy schedules to be with us this morning. It's great to see you both. As agreed, we will aim to finish this session at 10 o'clock sharp. Mr. Watt, I believe that you would like to begin by making a short opening statement.
Yes, thank you, convener. I'll do that if that's okay with you. As members of the committee will know, the Scottish National Investment Bank is a publicly owned, mission-led development bank. We were launched at the end of November last year and built our team from scratch from that point to the point now where we believe we are delivering on our missions. The bank is a mission-led investor, and we've been set three missions by the Scottish Government to support the transition to net zero, to build communities and promote equalities, and this also obviously covers the fair transition, and to harness innovation in a way that enables our people to flourish. And that innovation will in itself hopefully solve some of the problems of creating a net zero world. The bank set up to offer long-term commercial finance and projects and businesses that can help, that can potentially transform impacts on Scotland's society and economy. Why commercial, you may ask? It allows us to crowd in more external capital. It allows us to create a bank that can then reinvest the proceeds of past investments. It's a better use of public money to invest capital rather than just to give grants. And ensures good projects that would not otherwise happen will get funded. We don't see a tension between commercial returns and our missions. We believe that we should and must do both. We offer both debt and equity, and we can invest from as low as £1 million to as high as £50 million in green projects, green businesses, and the greening of business, which is slightly different. The Scottish Government has said that it will capitalise the bank for £2 billion over 10 years. We've been active since our launch, and we've announced seven investments totalling £120 million. In the first quarter of this financial year, we have made investment commitments of £62 million, of which £50 million has been drawn. So we are on track to invest the commitment of £200 million that was in the Scottish budget for this year. Our investments are helping to deliver a range of innovative and exciting projects across tidal energy innovation, lower than net zero insulation for homes, forestry, and electric vehicle charging. We also have a pipeline of investments we're working on, some of which will certainly contribute to our net zero mission. So maybe, convener, at that point, I could pause and hand back to yourself.
Thanks very much for those opening remarks, Mr. Watt. We'll now move on to questions. And my first question is on the remit of the bank you mentioned in your opening statement, because according to the missions, when the bank was set up, the primary mission was to deliver a step change in economic growth and accelerate the move to net zero. Given this mission statement, what criteria does the bank apply in making individual investments or prioritising across sectors? And how are investment opportunities identified? Does the bank have an origination function, or are opportunities referred to the bank from other enterprise agencies and other public agencies? And the third element of this question is looking at the investments made to date by the bank. Some are in what you might call passive funds, you know, funds managed by other third parties rather than direct investments in operating companies. I wonder if you could talk us through the rationale behind the investments in those more passive vehicles.
Ely, I'll maybe take the last part of that question about the funds. Would you like to talk about the creation of the team to initiate investments and what that looks like? But I'll maybe finish the last part. I think it was always envisaged that the bank could invest in funds. As I said earlier on, we've been building an investment team from scratch over the last few months. And there are a number of areas in which it is better for us to invest around another team that has critical skills. So, for example, in forestry, I think investing alongside and helping to crowd in private capital will allow our investment in that fund to go further than trying to do that ourselves. And the fund needed our capital to get off the ground. So it wasn't as if we were just investing in something that was already in place. It wasn't in place until our investment was made. The same was true with the Places for People affordable housing fund. That could not get off the ground without our capital. But with our capital, it enabled it to crowd in significant external money from the likes of the Strathclyde Pension Fund. And in both those cases, we felt that the work of the fund was directly aligned with our missions. The Places for People fund is around affordable housing, people that do not qualify for social housing but are not wealthy enough to afford a deposit for owner occupation. And often these people are working in the health service, in hospitality, or in the teaching professions. And it's really important that those people are able to live near the places that they work. With the forestry fund, I think what was really different there was that it was a new planting fund based on high principles, which would allow the planting of new forestry in places where it hadn't been before, which extends, I think, the green footprint of tree planting. But maybe on that point, I'll hand over to Ely to talk about deal origination and how we work with the enterprise agencies.
Yeah, sure. Thank you, Willie, and thank you, convener. In our language, we talk about direct and indirect origination. The fund's investment is, as you called it, passive, and Willie just talked through that, and we call it indirect. With direct investment, it's us investing directly in businesses and projects. We have built a good investment origination team now. We now have 20 people on that. At the beginning of the year, I only had two. So we have been building that origination capacity. Since the launch of the bank, a lot of the media coverage around the bank has meant that a lot of opportunities have come directly to us. And some have come through the agencies, but a lot of them have come directly into the bank. And also, as we've been building the origination team, a lot have come in through networks that the origination team has, and I have, and Willie has, and others have in the market. And that's naturally how banking investment origination works. We're very keen to address all, so whether an investment opportunity comes in through an agency or directly to the bank or through a networking event or origination activity, all of those are considered equally, whether they're a good investment opportunity for the bank or not. Obviously, in making our investments, we're always looking to both deliver a commercial return and mission impacts to deliver our missions in the longer term.
Thanks very much, both, for those answers. Very brief questions to follow up in this area. Are there any excluded sectors in terms of what the bank would invest in? And secondly, when you're looking at investment priorities strategically, do you meet with the Scottish Government's Economic Advisory Council to discuss overall strategy?
Shall I take the first part of that, Willie, on ethical exclusions? We will actually on our website. One major exclusion that we have is not to invest in the extraction of oil and gas, as that we believe cuts across our net zero mission. There are some other exclusions that are fairly common to most financial institutions, such as not investing in munitions, only using, not investing in anything that would use animal testing, for example, in an inappropriate way. So for cosmetics versus the, obviously with life sciences, sometimes it's necessary. And a number of other ethical exclusions around gambling, tobacco, and munitions, which are generally avoided by the investment industry these days. But obviously, given the nature of the bank, we want to have the highest ethical investment standards that we can, and our ethical investment policy sets those, and we consider those as we consider investments through the investment committee process.
And
maybe I can...
Yes, please.
Sorry, Convener, I didn't mean to cut across you. Just picking up on the other part of your question. I mean, we do talk to the policy teams across government in the different parts of the Scottish Government that are relevant to our missions. And we try and give feedback where we think there could be policy changes that would benefit those sectors. And we do try and meet regularly with the Cabinet Secretary and senior civil servants. But we do feel that we have complete freedom to define how we should tackle our missions. The missions are clearly set by the Scottish Government, as you know, but in terms of how we as a bank interpret the best way to go about meeting those missions, that is entirely a matter for the bank's board. We have put together a board that has very good credentials with regard to our missions, particularly the low carbon mission.
Thanks very much. My final question for the time being is something, Mr. Watt, you mentioned in your opening statement, the bank's capitalisation and budget. And I was trying to reconcile the amounts published in the Scottish Government's budget under the line item for the bank, which over the past couple of years, I think, is in the region of about £570 million, with the amount which has actually been invested and available to the bank, which is in the region of £120 million. Just trying to reconcile the difference in those line items, the amount made available through the Scottish Government budget as published over the last couple of years, and the amount which has been actually spent by the bank or made available to the bank. I understand in previous years some of those amounts previously allocated to the bank were, for obvious reasons, understandable reasons, were reallocated. But I would like to hear what you see as being the reason why, if you look at the Scottish Government's budget and you look at the bank's budget, you see two different amounts.
I'm not sure, Convener, I can fully answer that question. What I do know is that in the period before the launch of the bank, there were allocations that were made to the bank in the first instance, which were then redirected elsewhere, in part to do with the COVID emergency. But what I can say is that the bank's budget should align with the spending commitments in the current year, because that has been fully integrated into the way that we do things. Neither Ailey or myself were involved prior to the end. In my case, it was towards the end of 2019 that I first became involved. So some of this may relate to a period earlier than the one that you are talking about. We can, of course, take the question away and come back to you with a more thoughtful response. But it may relate both to COVID and to earlier periods. Ailey, is there anything you would like to add or subtract from what I just said?
Yeah, sure. I can add a little bit just on since I started, Willie. I guess I started in April 2020, and the primary focus of both our activities was launching the bank and also building it and building the governance framework within which we would make investments. And obviously, it was very important to get those building blocks in place. We did manage to do two investments, at one announced at the time of launch and one before the end of the what we call the stop period, the short financial year, from the end of November to the beginning of the end of March this year. And that with that combined with launch was a fairly significant achievement. We obviously were very focused on launch activities versus actual investment activities because we had to build the bank before we started to do investment in that period as well. So going forward, we now have the team in place and the governance structures in place that we need to make strong investment decisions, and we expect to deploy our committed capital this year in line with budget.
Thank you. A couple of members want supplementals in this area. Let me bring in Liam Kerr to be followed by Monica Lennon.
I'm very grateful, Convener. It was just something based on what you said in there, Ailey McTaggart, about a policy decision not to invest in oil and gas. Now, it seems to me there's a huge amount of research and innovation going in the oil and gas sector to transition oil and gas and to reduce emissions, which would seem to be right on point with what the bank's all about. So it rather occurs to me that if you take a policy of just refusing to consider anything oil and gas related, might there be unintended consequences of that?
Yeah, no, it's a good question. Thank you. The policy exclusion is oil and gas extraction rather than anything else in oil and gas transition and the use of technologies and tapping into what was the oil and gas centres, now the Net Zero Centre in Aberdeen, and their expertise in offshore to transition and use that in the offshore wind industry, for example, is absolutely something we would be interested in investing in. We are very keen to support the transition of Aberdeen and the North East into and the renewable energy sector away from oil and gas as that comes to fruition. So the exclusion is very limited to the extraction of oil and gas versus looking at using some of those technologies and transitioning some of those skills and workers into a new industry.
Thanks, Liam. Monica Lennon to be followed by Mark Ruskell.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to our witnesses. Forestry has been mentioned, clearly has a huge part to play in net zero. I am interested in the Gresham House Forest Growth and Sustainable Fund. There's been a wee bit of media coverage at the weekend, and it clearly is a substantial investment for the bank of £50 million. The fund is the UK's largest commercial forestry manager in charge of 140,000 hectares, not just of forestry in the UK, but also Europe and New Zealand, worth, I believe, £1.8 billion. So, first of all, can I ask, how was the fund identified? How did that come to the bank's attention?
Yeah, I can do that, Willie. Is that okay? So the fund approached us. They had been looking to raise capital. However, the nature of this forestry fund investment is slightly different to traditional forestry fund investments. So the fund is very much focused on planting. Traditional forestry funds are more focused on harvesting existing forests. And that is where you see a lot of private capital happy to invest, and the return profile is fairly consistent. because Gresham was wanting to move away from just harvesting existing forests, they wanted to move into replanting, and that required a more patient capital like the bank offers to support the growth before ultimate harvest and use for sustainable resources in the future and then replanting. The fund wasn't getting the traction that one of their traditional forestry funds would have done. And so they approached us to work with them on cornerstoning the fund. And in cornerstoning the fund, we have already attracted additional capital in. Currently, the bank's commitment is around 40% of the total fund commitments, and we expect them to raise further funds on top of that. And that is very much at the heart of what the bank has been set up to do in terms of cornerstoning new ideas. And this is it is a forestry fund, but it's a new type of forestry fund focused on planting versus immediate harvesting, and so a longer based return. And as a member of the investment committee, and I really like the idea that it supported our patient capital mantra as well.
Thank you. I wasn't sure if Willie wanted to add to that. I suppose what I'm wondering is, given this is a fund that's very well established, it's a huge amount of money, how can the public be confident that the bank won't be investing in funds that are already making money for those that are wealthy? I suppose what I'm trying to get at is, how does this particular investment contribute to a just transition for Scotland?
So a just transition from the oil and gas industry is sort of slightly to one side. Obviously, investing in anything, we keep an eye on all of our missions. Our police mission, as we call it, is primarily focused on addressing inequalities. This fund does actually provide jobs. By planting the forestry and the ongoing requirement to manage the forestry. So there is an additional economic activity, as well as the actual carbon sequestration that the fund will do through the planting of new trees. And as with all things, the bank is looking at making commercial investments alongside other investors who will be also making commercial investment alongside it.
Could I maybe pick up on the question, Ailey? Ms. Lennon, I think that investors in the fund will come from many different institutions, many of which will be pension schemes. And they will be local authority pension schemes, they will be company pension schemes. So they won't necessarily be wealth creation in the sense that you might imagine, but they will be from institutions that share some of the values that the bank has and want to invest in a long-term positive asset. The other point I would make is that the Committee for Climate Change has estimated that Scotland will need to invest $5 billion a year over the next, I think, 10 to 20 years if we're to solve the problems of carbon. That has to come from the private sector, and the private sector will only invest if it makes positive returns. So the alignment of making good investments that make sense for climate change and making commercial returns is a really important combination. And it's a combination that we want to foster and encourage. I don't know if that's helpful.
Yes, all of that is helpful. I was going to ask Ailey if she could maybe just expand on the job creation part and tell us how many new jobs the fund is expected to lead to. And maybe just for Willie, just as a final question for me. This investment, I'm just wondering if it will push the envelope in terms of good practice in commercial forestry, for example. Will it encourage more diverse planting to support native woodland targets? And will it require higher levels of certification, such as the UK Woodland Assurance Scheme?
Yes. Ailey, you probably know the detail. The answer is yes. But I'll hand over to Ailey because I think she knows the detail a bit better than me.
Yeah, so just on the jobs, it's expected that the fund will help, the investment forestry fund will help to sustain 200 existing jobs. The number I have is 214, so quite precise, but around 200 jobs, and deliver an estimated additional 567. And on top of obviously the mission impacts of additional planting and the positive contribution that makes to net zero. And on diversification, absolutely one of the things that attracted us to this fund was the diversified planting versus from the older, what is now seen as less good in terms of, you know, just spruce because it's fast growing. So that diversified woodland creation versus pure spruce forestry was a key driver in us making this investment. To that diversification, and also the fund will be following the highest level of certification in terms of the various regulation around those, and we have that built into the covenants on the investment, so it's a legal requirement as part of our contract to invest in them that they continue to do that.
Thank you very much.
Sorry, I was just going to add that we had a very detailed discussion about this at the final investment committee, because we knew that it would be important that the fund was investing to the highest standards. And so that was something that we discussed before we made the decision to back the fund.
If I may, just one final question then. Can I ask what percentage of the planting will be native species? Do you have that information to hand?
I don't have that to hand, unfortunately. Apologies, I can follow up with you directly.
That would be great.
Dig that out for you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Monica. Before I bring in Mark Ruskell, just one final question on the indirect investments and funds. Presumably, the bank will incur a fund management fee for making those investments. Am I right in that assumption?
Yes, absolutely.
And that's something the bank is comfortable with in terms of overall return on investment?
Yes, we consider the fees charged and negotiate hard on them. As any good investor would in any fund investment that we make, and ensure that they are in line with market, where we are cornerstoning, etc., we will normally look for a reduction in fee as a result of making that cornerstone investment. The commercial details of those are obviously confidential, but we are very much focused on the value for money element. And in investing in the forestry fund, one of the things I liked about it is the specialism required to invest in a forestry fund and do that fund is something that I probably wouldn't build into my investment origination team, because it's too specialised and you know, the dedicated resource versus the cost of the fund management fee. It's actually better to pay the fund management fee versus hiring an internal team to do that, given the specialised nature. And that also, that thinking was also applied to the PFP investment fund and how that is managed. And, you know, working with somebody like PFP, who's one of the largest social housing landlords in the country, have the skills and experience there that I, looking at the financial self-sustainability of the bank and the cost of in-housing people versus external.
Okay, thanks very much. Mark Ruskell, to be followed by Liam Kerr.
Yeah, thanks. Just a couple of follow-up questions. Firstly, about the exclusions and the ethical screening. I'm just interested in where you draw the line with this. I mean, you mentioned earlier, Ailey, about munitions companies. If there was, say, a munitions company that wanted to diversify into using some of their military hardware for, a technical application to do with climate change or whatever, would that be within scope in terms of your investment? And I suppose another example of that might be in relation to forestry. You know, obviously, massively welcome investments that are taking place, but how far do you go in terms of sort of screening how those investments are used in terms of marketing? So, for example, you know, Shell might say, oh, you know, come and fill up your car at this petrol station with our petrol and diesel, and it's fine because for every tank that you buy from us of fuel, you know, we're investing in another five trees. So it's kind of these kind of secondary ethical considerations. I'm just interested in where you draw the line in terms of your governance with these companies. And
sure, you happy for me to start on that, and you can add anything, Willie.
So
absolutely, we it's a judgment call, and that's why our investment committee speaks about these things in detail. And our any ethical investment policy will have de minimis thresholds in it as well. We are absolutely looking to encourage good behaviour and good transition. And so if there was a company that was doing something that wasn't, you know, particularly, you know, oil and gas and extraction is a good example of that transition. You know, munitions is generally something that banks would not invest in, and certainly not development banks. But there are a number of technologies, for example, you know, drones can be, you know, considered to be, you know, part of a munitions program, but they're also hugely useful for, you know, looking over forestry or agriculture and to see how that is performing. And so there's multiple uses, and we would absolutely consider each investment on its merits and look at the balance of what our money was going to be used for when we put it in there. And whenever we make an investment, the contract, the loan document or the shareholding agreement that we enter into for that investment contains a lot of detail about what people can and can't do with the money that we are giving them, and also includes a lot of reporting requirements whereby they have to tell us what they are doing with their money. And that we will often also, particularly in equity investments, we will have a board seat to enable us to look and see what is happening and what a company is doing with the investment money it receives from us. In something such that you've described in terms of, you know, helping a company transition away from something that we would consider unethical and into a more positive space, the covenants that we would put into our documentation would be very tight to ensure that we got that outcome from them. But absolutely, we would consider those investments on a case-by-case basis. Mm-hmm.
The only thing I would add to that is that the impact reporting that the bank will do, we have based it around the IFC, part of the World Bank's system, and so we have a whole framework for reporting, which we think gives us a systematic way of dealing with the challenges that you pose, which are real.
So you mentioned, earlier that you have a seat on the board of some of the companies that you're investing in. I know that's something that some other fund managers do, like Baillie Gifford with their Positive Change program. I know have a very direct relationship with the sort of portfolio companies that they're investing in. Out of the seven investments that you've made so far, which of these companies do you have board representation on?
Let me run through them. We are in the process of appointing, because we've just closed some of these investments, representatives for the three of the equity investments we've made this year. And if you have a smaller equity investment, it doesn't always come with a board representative, but we do typically get board observer positions as well. In addition, on the two fund investments, we will sit, and so that's PFP and Gresham Forestry, will sit on the advisory panel with the other limited partners in the fund, which will govern how the fund invests the money and ensure that they stay true to the original mandate in which we've invested.
Okay. It would be useful if we could get that in a list to the committee. Just thanks.
Thanks very much. Mark, let me bring in Liam Kerr, please.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning. A few just straight questions on the finances, because this isn't my area at all of expertise. I'm just looking back through SPICE briefing, which estimated the setup and operating costs between 2018 and 23 at 49.9 million. But of course, that was before COVID. So what are the current estimated costs to fully establish the bank? What do you project to be the annual operating costs going forward? And when is the bank expected to meet the operating costs from its revenue income?
Ailey, do you want to start on that, and then I'll maybe come in?
Sure. I'll start with the second part first, if that's okay, Mr. Kerr. So in terms of financial self-sustainability, it's something that we are very focused on achieving. We expect to achieve it in the medium term. The important thing about financial service sustainability is the fluctuating returns and investments. So we may, for example, hit it in year four or five, but what we will want to do is make sure that we can sustain it before we, you know, call ourselves financially self-sustaining for the longer term. In terms of our operating costs for this year, they are estimated to be around 15 million, with additional income that the bank will make to contribute to that cost as well. We won't fully cover that cost this year or in the next couple of years. We do not expect to. And it very much depends on the build of the portfolio. Now, obviously, we are actively looking for origination investments. Our patient capital nature of the investments we make means that the returns tend to be back-ended and slower in coming through. If we invest in debt, we will get a more immediate return on our capital in terms of coupon on the debt. If we invest in equity, a lot of the equity businesses we are investing in, given the early stage of them, the return horizon for them is a lot longer. And obviously, as you've heard me say already today, the Forestry Fund is a longer-term patient capital investment because it's more focused on planting than it is on immediate harvesting, where you would get a more immediate return. So we are balancing the patient capital that was identified as needed for the Scottish economy and one of the building blocks for why the bank was established, and carefully managing our costs as much as we can internally and with a view to getting that financial self-sustainability. In terms of the costs before launch, a lot of the project costs happened before I joined the programme, and so I'm not able to answer that in exactly, but we could try and follow up. We would have to tap into some of our civil service colleagues in government to get some of the pre-launch costs, which they were responsible for, rather than the costs since launch that Willie and myself are responsible for.
That would be great. I guess I'm just really looking for whether 49.9 million is still the salient figure. And perhaps as a very short follow-up question to that, there's obviously quite a significant cost to the taxpayer. Is there any concern about a duplication of cost to the taxpayer, given the other agencies involved in this sort of area that we've heard about earlier this morning?
Well, maybe I could take that one, Ailey. I mean, I think it's really important that there is no duplication, and that we work effectively with the other agencies that are in the ecosystem. So, for example, Scottish Enterprise focuses very much on early stage, earlier stage than we would. But of course, that means that when Scottish Enterprise investments start to mature, the bank is there to help them scale up. And of course, there are grant fundings that are available from various agencies, but they are rarely enough to fully fund the commercial projects that we are looking at. So the bank is really there to cornerstone and to also gap fund. So those are the things that we are doing. And we regularly communicate with South of Scotland, Highlands and Islands, and Scottish Enterprise to make sure that what we're doing fits into something that is seamless for companies.
Thank you very much. I wonder if I might explore something slightly different, and again, this might just be clearing up my understanding. I think I'm right in saying that the bank is not currently authorised or regulated by the Prudential Regulatory Authority or the Financial Conduct Authority. And in my understanding, how is it still a bank, given that it's not so regulated? And if that's right, do you have any plans to formally become a bank or become so regulated?
We took a lot of advice before launch as to whether we could do the work that has been set for us without being regulated. And the advice from the bank's own advisors and also the government's advisors was that we could do that. And that is a position that the Financial Conduct Authority is entirely comfortable with. I guess we are a bank in the sense of being a development bank. You know, banks cover a multitude of sins, as you will well know. And we are a very focused institution in that development bank space. So I think the use of the word bank is permissible. The second part of your question is, do we intend to become regulated by the FCA? And the answer to that is yes. We have stated that publicly. We think that that is important to the ongoing development of our missions, because you know, $2 billion over 10 years is a significant amount of public funds, and we are very, very mindful of the stewardship of that public capital, but it is not enough to achieve the objectives that we have to meet our missions. And so to do that, we need to be able to manage third-party capital. And to be able to manage third-party capital, we believe we need to be FCA regulated, because that will give people confidence to give us their capital to manage. So Ailey and her team are leading a project with the FCA, which is happening now.
I understand. I'm very grateful. I see that the British Business Bank publishes a rate of return to demonstrate the taxpayers' return on investments, and they target with a targeted return on average capital employed of over 2%. Does your bank plan to do likewise?
The legislation that set the bank up does envisage a target rate of return being set for the bank. We believe that the bank should have a target rate of return, and we have started work on how that should be calculated, over which period, and how it should be met. And we will be working in consultation with the Scottish Government on that factor. But the answer is yes, we do think it's important. We need to make a positive net return, and we need to be scientific about working out what that should be, given the activities that the bank is involved with.
Thanks very much. Let me bring in Colette Stevenson, and to be followed by Jackie Dunbar.
And good morning. Thanks. Yeah, actually, sort of answered my question from earlier when I was going to ask about what discussions had been undertaken in terms of the local government pension schemes. I just want to sort of drill down a wee bit more on that. So you touched upon Strathclyde Pension Fund. I was just wondering, what other local government pension schemes have you been having discussions with? And also as well, you know, the pension schemes have been under a lot of scrutiny as well, in terms of disinvestment as well from and more ethical investment. Is that something that's formed part of those discussions as well? And I suppose it's trying to catalyse on the investment as well, and just what's planned going forward.
Mm. Ailey, maybe I could start, and then I'll pass over to you about the specifics. I think you're absolutely right that local authority pension schemes do have an interest in sustainability in their investment activities. They also, because of the nature of their liabilities, which are very long term, in terms of the pensions that they provide for their members, they're also innately long-term investors. So there is an alignment of interest, I think, between the values of the bank and the values of pension schemes, and in a Scottish context, the local authority schemes across Scotland are important. I've already mentioned Strathclyde as being someone we've already partnered with. So yes, I would see this as being an area where we could develop our links over time, and would be a natural fit for us. But I'll hand over on that note to Ailey to add anything you might want to add.
Sure, and just to answer the question of to whom we've spoken ahead of launch of the bank, aside from co-investment and with Strathclyde and the PFP fund, I did have I had a conversation with Strathclyde, and I've also spoken with Lothian, and I expect to speak with more of the schemes from my previous life, where I manage money for a lot of UK local authority pension funds. I know that they are all very focused on investing in sustainability. All of them have been on the ESG journey for a long time, and ensuring that not only do they provide their pension investors with sufficient security for their returns, because that's obviously the primary purpose, make sure that they can pay their pension holders the pensions when they are required, but they have also all, without exception across the UK, the ones I've seen, been very focused on trying to improve the sustainability element of their investments, but doing so responsibly. I know from previous conversations, not necessarily with the Scottish pension funds, but with others, that just exiting all of their, you know, historic oil and gas investments is not a smart thing for that industry to do, because that industry still supports a lot of jobs and everything else. However, they are looking to look at their portfolios on a net zero basis, which I think Mr. Kerr talked about in his previous question, is that continued balance between what we need to do and what we can do to counter that investment versus, you know, a car versus a treat plant, etc., that Mr. Kerr touched on as well. Does that help, Ms. Stevenson?
Yeah, I think it's just good to hear that the local government pensions are on board with you as well, and they're taking serious, you know, net zero going forward. You know, you sort of alluded to that you are in discussions with Lothian and Strathclyde. Has there been any others that have came forward in terms of how you do that, you know, crowd and investment going forward? And is that, you know, is that on your radar, basically?
It is, and we also talked to some of the pooled pension schemes as well. So people like Pension Investment Corp, for example, where Strathclyde and others invest. So, you know, ongoing conversations. It is early days, and we are, you know, connecting with everybody, and we will continue to do so. And as Willie's already touched on, and through response to the FCA question, we are very keen to raise additional capital to invest alongside us. And as we get through our initial launch phase and then looking into the future of managing that additional capital, once we have the regulatory permission to do so, we will pick up those conversations with pension funds and other investors who would like to invest alongside us, because we would hope it wouldn't just be the local authority pension funds that would be interested, but obviously they would be a great asset to have alongside us investing, and we could help them and they could help Scotland as a whole.
Thanks very much, Colette. Jackie Dunbar has a question to be followed by a final question from Fiona Hislop. Jackie.
Thank you and good morning. I'll be brief because I realise that time's getting on. How does the bank interpret its legal objects in relation to supporting a well-being economy? And what does supporting well-being mean to you in terms of how you approach identifying and assessing investment opportunities?
Ailey, do you want to take that one?
Yeah, sure. So every investment opportunity we look at, sorry, Willie, you said I was to take it, and he crackled as he said it. Yeah, okay, thanks. When an investment opportunity comes in, the first filter, if you like, that we apply to that investment opportunity is to look at our missions and identify which mission that opportunity aligns with primarily, whether that be net zero or PLACE, as we call it for short, which is very, very much focused on improving equality and improving well-being through investing in communities. And the innovation mission, which is more focused on investing in companies like N2 or R3 and looking to the future economy of Scotland. For me, all three missions have an element of well-being on a personal level, because obviously the net zero mission is obviously very important for the human race as a whole, and the police mission particularly looks at the community building and the improvement of equality across that. So we wouldn't invest in anything that would go against our missions, and that is how we make sure that we are promoting that well-being piece across the place, across all of our investments, in the same way that we wouldn't invest in something that would cut across our overall net zero idea. I talk about it more as a common theme, and that well-being of the economy of Scotland and the people of Scotland, who are ultimately our beneficiaries, is very core to the investment decisions that we make.
Thanks very much, Jackie. Fiona Hislop, please.
Thank you, and good morning. Good to see you. I'd like to just recognise the major achievement of setting up a bank from scratch during a pandemic, and Ailey, you coming into post in April 2020 was an interesting time. I want to kind of look to the future, and recognising that we're still in a pandemic, there's also the influences of COP26 and some of the objectives that globally have to be met, not just by governments, but by private finance. So can you maybe comment as to how you see the market going forward, bearing in mind the bank is, yes, looking at cornerstone financing, but also gap financing? And have you seen changes even over the last year, or what would you might forecast in terms of generation of private capital and for green, the major billions of green investment that are going to be required for the world to meet net zero?
Maybe I could start with that, Ailey, and hand over. Ms. Hislop. I think there are areas of the market that are well served with private capital. For example, offshore wind, which has gone from being uninvestable 10 or 20 years ago to being fully financed now by the private sector. But I think in emerging technologies, there are gaps. So for example, in green hydrogen, I think there is a shortage of capital for projects in that area, because the uses of that finance are not yet proven. The uses of that technology may be proven on a small scale, but they're not proven on a large scale. The same might be true with regard to tidal power, and also to some of the service sectors that we have made investments in. And I hope that one of the things that we can do is prove that commercial investments can be made in these sectors, which will then give confidence to the private sector to come in, come in beside us. But Ailey, maybe I'll hand over to you on that point, and you can elaborate.
Thank you, Ms. Hislop. I've been hugely impressed and excited about the diversity of the pipeline of investment opportunities we are seeing from Scotland. It gives me a great amount of confidence that the bank is here at the right time to do the right things in investing there. As you will remember, Mrs. Lott, before we launched the bank, we had to get state aid approval from the European Union, and a lot of that state aid approval is focused around crowding in versus crowding out, and ensuring that the money we invest isn't available to be invested in the private sector. We continue to follow that guidance as we have been told to do, and as is the policy across the piece. And so whenever we're looking at an investment opportunity, we will actively quiz and query the investee company or the borrower as to whether they have been, could actually find that money in the private sector, because obviously we wouldn't want to crowd that money out. There is ample opportunity for investment. The private sector does have a lot of cash at the moment to invest in things. A lot of private sector funds are very focused on investing in green at the moment, and as Willie identified, things like offshore wind, they do not need public capital anymore. Typically those deals are heavily oversubscribed by the private sector. But there are continuing things in your investment in Nova Tidal, for example, that tidal technology required a bit more proving, and I hope that by the time they get to their next investment round, that a combination of the bank's investment and further proving of the technology will allow further private capital to come into that investment. And that is absolutely the reason for our existence, is to try and lead the way in those. And, you know, back to the forestry fund, you know, one would typically expect a forestry fund to find it easy to raise money. The Gresham Fund didn't, because it was focused on planting in a slower horizon for return, which for us matched our patient capital mantra. And by cornerstoning and investing in that and doing the hard work on that, it already has attracted additional capital in. So it's something we're very focused on and conscious of. But I am constantly saying to Willie and our board that I'm hugely excited about the diversity of the pipeline that we have building in the bank.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thanks, Fiona. That brings us to the end of this session. Let me once again thank both of our guests for attending this morning, for your time. We very much appreciate it. Enjoy the rest of your day. I will now suspend this session for a panel changeover. Thank you. Welcome back, everyone. I'm pleased to welcome our second panel of witnesses this morning. Thank you very much, everyone, for joining us. We have joining us remotely Audrey McKeever, Highlands and Islands Enterprise, Martin Valenti, South of Scotland Enterprise, Claire Renton, South of Scotland Enterprise, Andy McDonald, also of Scottish Enterprise, and Ewan Mearns, Team Leader Strategy, Scottish Enterprise. Good morning, everyone, and thank you for taking time out and joining the committee this morning. And thank you also for the very valuable written submissions you provided to the committee in advance. As we have a large panel this morning, I would ask members of the committee to please indicate who on the panel their questions are addressed to. And if a panel member wishes to contribute, please raise your hand or type R for a request to speak in the Blue Jeans platform. We will now move on to questions. And the first question I have, and it's actually a question to each agency, perhaps starting with Scottish Enterprise, then Highlands and Islands, and then South of Scotland. The question I have is on policy alignment and how the agencies ensure that the transition to net zero is being coordinated across agencies and government. In particular, how much specific guidance do the agencies receive from the Scottish Government in terms of the priorities you should implement in the transition to net zero? So if I could begin with that question being put to Scottish Enterprise, please.
I will take that on behalf of Scottish Enterprise, given I'm within the strategy team. So we work very closely with the Scottish Government and agencies in terms of coordinating what we do, but also aligning our activities with policy. We receive a ministerial guidance letter each year, which sets out ministers' expectations of Scottish Enterprise, but we are in regular contact with Scottish Government policy teams and ministers in between times. We collaborate very closely on an ongoing basis and also via the Strategic Board on business planning processes, but also operational issues as well, to make sure that we offer consistent advice and a business support system across the whole of Scotland that businesses are able to access.
Thank you very much. And the same question to Highlands and Islands, please. I'm afraid you. We can hear you now. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Yeah, we do follow the very similar approach in terms of the ministerial guidance that we get each year. Very much involved in terms of at the strategic board level, in terms of our planning, and also I guess just really to highlight that there, you know, at very many levels, there is very close working between government and the agencies right across the broader net zero agenda. I think what we've witnessed over the last, 18 months, 2 years, is a lot greater efforts to ensure that that doesn't just fall in the energy space, it doesn't just fall in the business space, there is a real coordination of efforts and indeed seeking to align funding as well, so that there is really sort of a clear understanding of what are the outcomes that we're all trying to achieve. So I do think it's strong in terms of the alignment. I think there's still areas where we really do need to continue working, and that would be, I would propose, around measurement and in terms of how we measure the outcomes here relating to net zero. But broadly at a sort of strategy level, very, very clear. And I think that's reflected in our own operating plan in terms of how net zero is really peppered throughout that. And indeed, we're very involved just now in terms of the 3-year strategy and indeed feeding into the 10-year economic transformation strategy as well.
Thank you very much. And that question also to South of Scotland Enterprise, please.
Thank you. And rather than repeat what you've heard from Ewan and Audrey, I would say is that about that alignment, we're in very close conversation all the time with Andy and Audrey and from High and SC, because we realise this is a Team Scotland coordinated effort. And I think we work very closely with lots of government departments, and we're thankful for that, but not just our respective sponsorship teams, but also with teams from other parts of government, just to kind of get that broader perspective to make sure that policy alignment is clear for us, because that the more we understand the alignment, the more we're able to help and support the businesses and communities in our area. So rather than just repeat again about the ministerial guidance letter, that's really important. But I think what's really quite critically important is that practical relationship they have between the other agencies, not just the economic agents, but the nature agency, the regulatory agencies, and those bodies that support them. I think that's quite important.
Thanks very much. I'd like to follow up on a couple of the issues raised in those opening answers. I think the Strategic Board was mentioned a few times. The ministerial guidance letter from the Scottish Government was mentioned, and I've seen a copy of those in the past. I guess what would be helpful is to understand what specific targets are set by the Scottish Government to each agency, and or what internal targets do you have so that we or you can see a real outcome on an annual basis or a longer term basis in terms of not just strategy and alignment, but real results in that transition to net zero. What metrics do you use? What internal measurements do you use to assess your progress towards the transition to net zero? And I suggest we take the same order we had the questions previously, starting with Scottish Enterprise, please.
Thank you, Convener. So Scottish Enterprise delivers its activities and reports its activities in the context of the Scottish Government's National Performance Framework. So that really is the context for how we work. We're an evidence-led organisation, so we measure and then report on our activities on a regular basis. In addition, we have our own measurement approach internally, so what we need to do is to ensure that we measure the activities that we're delivering, and of course that is evolving. So right now we're actively looking at our measures for our next three-year plan, and this is in the context of the Scottish Government's National Strategy for Economic Transformation, which I believe will be published later this year. So for many years we have looked to measure activities in relation to net zero. So in particular we've measured CO2 savings as a direct result of the activities that we deliver. We've also this year introduced a measure for green jobs, and we've had activity to support company investment in new projects that will result in green jobs. But we're looking to broaden that. So right at the moment, we're looking at other activities that measure company investment, that measure their impact in terms of social as well as environmental outcomes, and that, as we just said, is something that we're talking to the other agencies about.
Thank you. Same question to Highlands and Islands, please.
Thank you. Yes. Yeah, really, in addition to that, where HIE's been focusing its efforts currently is around what we're calling a net zero ladder. So looking at how we can track progress of the companies and communities, organisations that we engage with in terms of their awareness of net zero and what it means for them as an organisation, but also right through to really adopting net zero practices, good practice in this space, and to really, you know, in terms of their own carbon measurement and in terms of their own processes. But this is currently under development, and certainly would be happy to share more details with the committee as that progresses. I think there are a rationale for doing this is really to ensure that we are or recognising that this is a transition, and that engaging with our clients, we want to work with them through that transition, and that we want to collectively learn as to how to make those next steps and understand more clearly what those barriers or challenges might be, but also to make sure that it really is generating an impact in terms of carbon reduction, in terms of that contribution to net zero. So I think there's just a bit more the reason for doing this is really, just say, to sort of engender that more behavioural approach to net zero, as opposed to just only quantifying sums at the end of an investment, if you like. We want to be able to track progress over time.
Thank you very much. And the same question to South of Scotland Enterprise, please.
Thank you, Convener. I think I'll answer a part of it, then my colleague Claire will answer another part about the metrics that we're looking at developing. It's actually very exciting to be involved in SOSI at this stage. It's a fairly new agency, as the panel will know, and I'm only 55 days, I think, into the role, so it's everything's new in this respect. But we're kind of, as Ewan rightfully said, this is evidence-led agency, but we're also kind of like leaning into opportunity-led. Where is the opportunities for that just transition to net zero, and how do we align our strategy, working with all of those government agencies and partnership agencies and the business and the private sector, and how do we bring them to bear to deliver the impact that SOSI was set up to do? And I think on that point, I'll maybe hand over to my colleague Claire and maybe tell you about some of those, how we're measuring some of those impacts.
And inquiring about the approach from SOSI regarding impact and measurement. As Martin said, we are a new agency and we're developing our systems and procedures. It's really been a good and exciting time for us because our focus is around making sure this is relevant, responding to national strategies and making sure that we're focusing on the needs and understand the needs of the South of Scotland. So in terms of developing that, we've been working with the University of Edinburgh and the data-driven initiative to really have a focused and bespoke approach which meets the diverse needs of all our businesses, communities, initiatives and projects. So that we have a measuring system that is relevant and is responding to the net zero agenda. We currently have three trial projects underway, which is testing out that impact and measurement framework. And again, we'd happily share that with the committee as we develop and progress on the thinking and the testing of this model, but really focused on creating a local and bespoke approach, which actually captures the full range and benefits from the very small communities that we work with through to the bespoke range of businesses we're working with, but making sure that we really challenge ourselves to be doing things differently and engaged and collaborative, and obviously sharing that experience with our agency colleagues as well across Scotland.
Thanks very much. Just a very brief follow-up from me, because quite a few of our guests have mentioned the creation of jobs as part of the net zero transition and the overall agenda, because I think that's going to be a key challenge in delivering a just transition to develop a Scottish supply chain in emerging areas of technology that make sure that the jobs of the future are created and remain in Scotland. That hasn't really happened at scale in the past decade. My question is, what needs to be done differently to make sure that we can develop that Scottish supply chain and those high technology jobs? I guess, first of all, Scottish Enterprise, please.
Thank you. We're fully committed to supporting a just transition, and we want to support good and green jobs which are well rewarded. So that's our focus. For example, what we've done recently over this summer is we delivered a call to businesses to come forward with innovative projects to create jobs and safeguard green jobs. We're just in the process of evaluating the responses we had to that call, but we had a really positive response to that. So in terms of delivering a just transition, we've been talking to the been keeping close to the work of the Just Transition Commission and working with the Secretariat within the Scottish Government. So what we need to do is to support that economic activity here in Scotland. We want to retain those jobs and those businesses, given that we've got a clear, strong strategy focused on the net zero transition. We want to help those businesses to transition towards a net zero future, and that's very much what we're focused on doing. We can maybe talk a little bit more about some of the operational support, but in generality, that is our approach in terms of the just transition.
Thanks very much. Same question to Hai, please.
Thank you. Yes, I think really focusing on the strategic opportunities that net zero presents, we believe presents the Highlands and Islands region with real opportunity to create new employment. The prospect of quite significantly greater offshore wind around our waters, and also that moving into deeper waters and looking at floating wind, for example. We believe that the region's infrastructure and the supply chain is in a relatively strong position to try and capitalise on that. Now, I totally appreciate that we perhaps we're not in the position now that we had hoped to have been 10, 15 years ago at the earlier leasing rounds for offshore wind, as an example. However, I'm really encouraged by the much more collaborative approach that we're seeing from developers, from OEMs, and working with the local infrastructure providers and the local supply chain at an early stage. And much of that will be stimulated, I've no doubt, around the real industry commitment to increase Scottish or UK content, but Scottish and Highlands and Islands contents. We're seeing it in those projects and the measures that have been put in place around supply chain development statements and also within the CFD process around the supply chain plans. However, we do appreciate it still as a global market, so therefore there's a lot we need to focus on, and we're very actively working closely with Scottish Enterprise, with Skills Development Scotland, and with the with SOSI as well, but also with Scottish Government and with the agencies or other organisations like the Net Zero Technology Centre, also to really identify not just the business opportunities but the skills needs that are going to be required, and really planning ahead for those skills so that we can enable that transition of jobs into from particularly from oil and gas sector, but from indeed from other sectors, into the jobs that will be created in the offshore wind space. And just if I may quickly, without hijacking this slot, but really just to indicate that indeed we recognise other areas around green hydrogen, and for our region particularly around tidal energy and wave energy in future. But actually what we're really keen to do is continue to build on the successes that we've seen both at the European Marine Energy Centre in Orkney and also with the outputs of Wave Energy Scotland. So in those sort of technology areas, those energy generation areas, I do believe that there will be opportunities that we need to continue to work closely with industry and to try and to secure those. And indeed, if I was quickly to touch on the other areas around heat and transport, the measures that have to be taken there and the progress that has to be made, we have to create those opportunities and also for those to be built in many of our rural and coastal areas as well.
Thank you very much for that answer. Same question to South of Scotland Enterprise. Then I believe Andy MacDonald of Scottish Enterprise would like to follow up after that.
Your mic stop.
Is someone from South of Scotland Enterprise able to say that question? Yeah.
It is, convener. Sorry, the mic was off, so it's just come back on. So I'll take that if that's okay. So welcome the question around creation of jobs, particularly under the net zero, and the aspect about the supply chain from our perspective in the South of Scotland. We've been very proud in the first 15 months of identifying that we've retained 2,000 jobs with our help and support and created another 1,000 more, of which green jobs are embedded into that. And we really are looking forward to actually see how we can create more opportunities for the South of Scotland. In terms of our local supply chain, we've identified that there is a significant amount of sole traders and SMEs. So that's a really focus for us in terms of building capacity and resilience and looking at the current skill set and transferable skills. It's really important that we work with our cross-agency colleagues, such as Developing Scotland's Young Workforce, to create pathways for our young people in retraining into the green job sector and these opportunities that these bring. And we're seeing very very much active activity with our colleges, Dumfries and Galloway College and Scottish Borders College, in terms of their proactiveness and understanding that we need to be a readiness and active in green jobs, with the Green Skills Academy and embedding sustainability in all the courses. We see opportunities with supply chain across tourism, construction, property, food and drink, creative industries. So they all have a role and opportunity in creating green jobs with new businesses and communities. A lot of the work that we're looking at is around the current skill set and identifying the new skills that are required, making sure that we capitalise on opportunities for transferable skills, also the ability to teach new skills. We're mindful that with our supply chain, with 10,000 of our businesses, with 10 people or less, this can be quite challenging for them. They're working hard to give them opportunities to actually develop and grow, to respond to the needs and opportunities that working to develop our business and communities to deliver net zero will give. So while it is a challenge, we understand the level of challenge that's on our plates and are prepared and ready for taking this forward into the future opportunities.
Thank you very much. And finally, Andy McDonald wants to come in.
Thank you, Convener. And my colleagues have covered a number of the things I was going to raise. I think you mentioned, you asked at the start of this the question about where have we learned from previous experience. We began supporting offshore renewables many, many years ago. And one of the things that was very clear in terms of trying to get businesses engaged with that to then create employment was a real need for education about what was different and what the things were you needed to understand to move into new areas. And as we've diversified further more recently with the opportunities in heat and the opportunities in transport, that's become even clearer, and particularly some of the scale-up that colleagues have referred to, particularly in the heat area, for example. Not only do we need to manufacture technology like heat pumps, we need to be able to install those at a rate of knots in order to achieve the targets we have for decarbonisation. And there's a great deal of opportunity in there, but there are also a number of small companies we need to have the capacity to learn where those new opportunities are and how to adapt to them. So we've brought in support programmes to focus attention, short burst of attention to those companies to help them understand that. We've developed cluster builder programmes in order to get companies engaged with each other across the industry and opportunities to understand there. And we've created and supported the development of offshore wind clusters, for example, to bring together communities of companies so that they can work together and understand where those challenges lie. And then obviously align the programmes of support that we're bringing to those companies behind those in order to deliver the support that they need to then take up those opportunities. And also the international element is important as well, and particularly in the likes of the diversification of the oil and gas sector. Those companies in many cases have a lot of experience of working in international markets. So we've also been looking at how we take those the opportunities in those new technology areas and recognise where those are also opportunities internationally to work with those businesses through our colleagues in SDI and in the broader organisations as well.
Thanks very much. A few of the panel members mentioned they were working on transition plans to net zero and updated strategies. If and when those plans are ready, it would be appreciated if you could share them with the committee. Thank you very much. Let me pass over to Monica Lennon, who has a brief supplemental in this area, to be followed by Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. The Green Jobs Fund has been mentioned a few times and in some written submissions. So I just wondered, given there's been that call to businesses to apply for the fund over the summer, perhaps Scottish Enterprise could advise how many applications have been received in total and how many good green jobs you expect this first round of funding will create. Thank you.
Certainly, we're still working through the applications. The programme applications closed to the first round of the call in July. We anticipate completing the evaluation of them by the end of this month. We had over 200 applications for it, which was a significant number. I don't have immediately to hand the number of jobs, but we can certainly provide that. Unless my colleague Ewan may have that to hand.
Yes, just a little bit more information with the caveat that this is on the basis of what applicants have told us before evaluation. But from the the more than 200 applications that that Andy mentioned. The project of the potential to create more than 3,000 new jobs, transitioning more than 2,600 jobs, and protecting 1,800 existing jobs. So, you know, a sizeable and significant response to that call.
Thank you. And if I can just very briefly, because there isn't, you know, one overall definition of green jobs, in terms of the applications that have come in, do you think that there will be some companies who will be quite disappointed because they don't meet the criteria? And do you think we need to do more work to make sure that we have a good, robust working definition of green jobs?
I could happily take the answer to that. I suspect the answer will be yes. It's been clear that the programme is funded to an extent, but we expect to be evaluating projects, and it is not on everybody will succeed. The best projects will succeed and be taken forward. There's also a significant amount of learning in this call for all of us to understand what the businesses out there see as being the opportunities to focus on, and that will allow us to focus future elements and future versions of the call as well. And in terms of the definition to what is a green job, at the moment we have tried to be as open as we can and as wide as we can in order to understand how we support companies without the danger of actually blocking development. And so transitioning to a green future is a key part of that. And as I say, a significant amount of learning we expect to take from this first call and share amongst us clearly and with colleagues in the Scottish Government to help us define what could be the right shape to define, or the right things to define as important in identifying green job support for the future.
Thank you.
Thanks, Monica. Jackie Dunbar to be followed by Colette Stevenson.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. My question is to Scottish Enterprise. I note in your submission that you're focused on stimulating early action in terms of supporting the transition to net zero. Can I ask what are these early actions and how will you or do you measure the success of them?
Maybe I can take that question first of all. So, yes, we have been we published our net zero framework for action in June, and we've been having a conversation with our board for probably the best part of 2 years in terms of exploring what else Scottish Enterprise could do to respond to the climate and nature emergencies. So this is both to help reduce emissions, but as others have said, to help focus on net zero opportunities and supporting a just transition. So the 2020s, many commentators talk about this being the decisive decade. So there really is an urgency for us to focus on this early action. So the framework that I mentioned is a 5-year plan, but most of the actions we're delivering this current year. So, for example, we're making sure that we're embedding net zero goals throughout the whole of the organisation, so aligning all of our support for innovation, investment and internationalisation, helping to unlock net zero opportunities in terms of the support we offer to industries and businesses. We are taking forward a number of strategic programmes of national significance to focus on the opportunities for Scotland as a whole, and we're working with industry and partners, investors on that. We've talked about the funding calls that we're delivering. We're holding a number of round tables with investors at the moment. There's a strong appetite from the investment community, as we heard earlier from the Scottish National Investment Bank. So we're wanting to align our support with the appetite that we see from the co-investors that we work with. We're also delivering a whole range of other early actions to make sure that internally our staff are well equipped in order to deliver on our ambitions. So at the moment we're delivering climate literacy training, targeting our senior leadership team. About 70 senior leaders across the organisation are completing that at the moment. But we're also offering net zero training to all of our staff in Scotland and overseas. And finally, we have two climate change champions on our board who are advising us in terms of the action. So there's a lot going on. We absolutely are committed to the net zero transition, and this is at the heart of everything that we're doing in our current business plan and in the future. And so we acknowledge the urgency to take action just now.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks very much, Jackie. Colette Stevenson, please.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning, everyone. I wanted to sort of focus in on each of you in terms of you talk about supply chain development programme and taking that forward. I should say that I used to sit on the actual board of supplier development programme, which as a councillor we were the host authority for. So one of the questions I wanted to ask each of you is, what are you actually doing in terms of, or have you done, put a legal clause in terms of supply chain visibility going forward? Maybe put that to Scottish Enterprise first, sorry.
I can answer that in part. In terms of the supply chain development activity that we undertake, then when we are working with companies looking to establish new opportunities, then clearly we're encouraging them to engage with and work with the Scottish supply base and trying to focus building the right suppliers for each of those companies. In terms of legal commitments, then clearly there are constraints around what you can legally do in terms of placing contracts and commitments in front of companies. From the support perspective, we currently ask companies to undertake their contracts on a fair work basis, but there are not constraints about supply chain. However, you'll be very aware, I suspect, that in the context of the next round of offshore wind, there are agreements and commitments from industry to set significant targets for local content, and clearly we're working with both the supply base and the developer base to bring companies together to understand how that's going to be achieved and to make sure that the supply chain and the supplier base in Scotland is particularly well resourced and able to meet those challenges to the extent that it can. We're also delivering as agencies collectively and in partnership with Scottish Government and industry directly and industry bodies, Making Scotland's Future programme and the industrial supply chain development programmes related to that. And looking at how we build the infrastructure that supports the development of supply chains, supply industry, the base of the companies, but then take that forward in terms of the resources that we're putting behind companies and intending to support the manufacturing supply base and better integrate it together. Not related to your question, but related to the supply chains, one of the challenges we've had is that we've tended historically to respond to opportunities to diversify the supply chain from oil and gas or from aerospace or from the marine sector. And one of the things that is now in place is a much more joined up approach to looking at what are the opportunities that exist for the whole of the Scottish supply base, whether that's in manufacturing supply chain or digital supply chain, and bringing those opportunities together in a much more focused fashion to then allow companies who may well be capable of acting in more than one of those sectors to actually identify what the skill sets are they have and look for the opportunities across a number of sectors to those.
Thank you. Sorry, if I could go to Highlands and Islands and ask that question as well.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Ms. Stevenson. Yeah, similar to Andy there in terms of restrictions around what we can or can't do in terms of any legal obligation. But I think, you know, we're very focused on working collaboratively with the industry just now and really, as I said earlier, that really encouraged by the response that we're seeing from industry. I think just as a bit of an example, and I know this hasn't yet translated into jobs, but just last week, Scottish Renewables and Renewable UK held their Floating Offshore Wind Conference in Aberdeen, And the demand on the clusters, in terms of the deep wind cluster, for example, which covers well, all of Scotland, but really focus on floating wind opportunities, was exceptionally high, and the conversations were very encouraging. So, you know, I think we've got reason to be optimistic around a more positive outcome from these current leasing rounds in terms of supply chain. But we do appreciate that it's not straightforward, and there are lots of risks there that we need to navigate through. You know, as an organisation, we've been very alert to, for example, the challenges around CS Wind and entering recently in administration. I think from HYDE's perspective, our main objective was around securing economic activity at that site, and we will continue to pursue that. But we have learned lots of lessons, and we will continue to learn those. And that's just, as I say, in the offshore wind space. I think the other aspect that's quite different now from where we were 10 years ago is just the pipeline, the scale and the pace that these projects will need to proceed at. Therefore, those developers that are taking forward these really, you know, multi-billion pound projects in relatively short order will have to look at a more collaborative approach as a solution to their delivery timescales. So I think that in itself will really present much more constructive dialogue for our business base. And our role as enterprise agencies is really to continue working with those businesses to understand what investment they need, whether that be in automation, digitalisation, really to make them very lean and competitive. And that's where working with the likes of the National Manufacturing Institute, you know, as an example, then we need to draw on that expertise to support our companies.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks very much. Colette, Mark Roskell, please.
Yeah, thanks very much, Convener. Morning to everybody on the panel. I was struck by some of the comments that you were making, Andy, earlier about the challenge with heat decarbonisation and, you know, enormously challenging. I mean, 1 million homes will have to be decarbonised by 2030 to meet government targets. I'm just wondering if you could perhaps just give us a bit more background as to how you see the skills gap around heat decarbonisation being filled, and also the relationship between your enterprise agencies and the new public energy agency that will be launched in Scotland. So in terms of delivery, how is this going to work? How are we going to develop those supply chains and deliver at a scale that we've never seen before in Scotland?
Thank you. So currently we have identified within Scottish Enterprise, 7 national programmes which are key areas of focus. One of those is around decarbonising heat. The rationale for that is bringing a focus across the whole of the organisational resources that we bring as an agency, and the same is true of our colleagues and other economic agencies as well, around this particular challenge. And in the context of heat, it's recognising there's a need to both build the technology base and the innovation around that and support companies in that space, and also recognise the challenges there are going to be in creating the workforce, transitioning existing companies, and for example, installers of heating systems, to cope with the new technology, but also just recognising that scale up. We've worked with Skills Development Scotland on the Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan, and that's been one of the strands in there that we've been in discussion with. I've been party to, but not in the middle of, discussions with, for example, with local authority partners as well through Skills Development Scotland on the implementation group for the Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan, and trying to understand how we're going to make sure the infrastructure is in place for that. From our perspective, we're also working with colleagues in Scottish Government in the heat team on the question, and the energy team, and the question of how we will resource those things up, bringing together the training and skills needs that will exist. So, looking at creating, in conjunction with industry, we've had a number of discussions about the creation of a heat hub of some form, which will focus the skills requirements and the development and delivery of those. It will bring industry in to understand the opportunities as well as the challenges in there. And clearly, we're seeing this as a significant opportunity. It's a challenge to do it, but it's a significant opportunity for Scotland to build an expertise in things like heat pump technology, build on some of the companies that are already here doing innovation and innovative developments in that space, but also to significantly scale that up. And these things will be required around the world as well. So again, there's an international dimension to it. The question of the skills element of it, it's bringing together things like the Construction Skills Innovation Centre and local councils, local authority training opportunities, and colleges as well as universities to bring together all the dimensions that are required to skill across the supply chain, and to make sure that those reach into communities. I think there's a very, we think there's a very big opportunity here in terms of community level opportunity as well. So there's a lot of vocational skill involved in these opportunities. We're going to be working in conjunction as the whole of Scotland, the whole of the public and private and public sector, partnering with private sector as well, through local authorities in things like planning and then the delivery of these things, working with housing authorities as well in the context of domestic heat. And there's a huge opportunity there to build an extraordinary level of skills opportunity. The challenge then is how do we make sure that's delivered? And that's where, again, working very closely with colleagues in Skills Development Scotland, that we bring that forward. In terms of your very specific question about the heat agency, the heat body, we're working with Scottish Government to understand how we deliver this in partnership with the structures that are in place. And as they develop that, I would fully expect that we'll be collaboratively engaged in that conversation to understand how we fit in and enable that to succeed.
Okay. Perhaps a question now for SOSI and also HIE as well. I mean, there's a commitment in the cooperation agreement between my party and Scottish Government to develop at least one national park in Scotland by the end of this session. And I just wondered what your perspectives are on that, if there are any lessons that we can learn from the existing national parks, and also national what you parks. See as the jobs opportunities with that.
Yes. I think my colleague Claire is going to answer that one.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, and thanks for the question. While SOSI have not been directly involved with the national park today, what we do have is good experience around the Galloway and Southern Ayrshire biosphere. It's been a 5-year project which SOSI are contributing the funding to explore and develop an economic and environmental model which is relevant and local to the region. And it's really focused about engaging the businesses and tourism and all the opportunities, obviously integrating opportunities with energy and transport to create a model to support this transition into our future and a net zero environment. So certainly it's very early days, but there's some good feedback and reporting which will be taken to our board. And we can follow up and share with this committee in the next month or so.
So will you be working with particular campaigns then in the south of Scotland around developing a prospectus for a national park, or is that outside of your remit?
Well, our focus is around the existing opportunities with the biosphere and that. If any of the organisations or parties are active in this area, then I'm sure we'll have dialogue, as with all community and business and opportunities for the south of Scotland.
Okay. And I don't know if there's perspective from HIE as well. There's been discussion about, for example, a marine coastal national park. I don't know if that's something that is on your radar at all. You're on mute, I think.
Hi there. Yeah, sorry. It's not something that I'm personally aware of, but certainly would, you know, be happy to come back with a high view on that. Other than, you know, obviously we work very closely with the Cairngorm National Park, and obviously in the context of the funicular that we're reinstating just now, but also in terms of the wider business benefits in that area. And in terms of marine, clearly, very alert, aware of that, with all of the interest around offshore developments, and whether that be in offshore energy or whether that be in aquaculture and whether that be in seaweed, you know, all of that presents really, you know, quite exciting opportunities, but obviously needs to be managed in a very careful way. And the approach to date in terms of Marine Scotland's marine planning has been really welcome, and in terms of alignment with Crown Estate Scotland with respect to leasing, again, is really is welcome in terms of just understanding the full process and enabling a careful planning and I guess engaging the coastal communities that are impacted by that. But maybe we'll need to come back with a more formal view on HAI's response to the potential for a new national park and what role we might have on that.
Thanks.
Thanks very much, Mark. Monica Lennon to be followed by Liam Kerr, please.
Thanks, convener. It was just to go back to the Green Jobs Fund. I just wondered if a proportion of the fund will be used to help those groups that are most underrepresented already in green sectors and green jobs. And I'm looking at some analysis by Close the Gap, for example, looking at women's opportunities and women's experience of the labour market, particularly during the pandemic as well. So I just wonder if that's something that's been looked at, and maybe to get a regional perspective if that's something that's particularly more relevant in perhaps Highlands and Islands or south of Scotland.
Thank you. In terms of the green jobs within the Highlands and Islands enterprise area, we're taking a slightly different approach in that we haven't launched a call as such, but what we took a view for this first year, where our budget allocated for the Green Jobs Fund was £800,000, was to look at projects that we were already aware of and we had a lot of interest anyway, and that were aligned to the objectives of the Green Job Fund. And what we've already committed to are a number of projects, ones including WindSwept, which is an innovative wind turbine technology using kite and fabric material that is in Shetland. Another award was made to US Distillery, which is fantastic in terms of in that location and creating a new business opportunities in US, and also making sure that from the outset that distillery is a green distillery. A more recent award has been to Trees for Life for a rewilding centre. So just to give an example of sort of some of the variety of the projects that we're supporting through the Green Jobs Fund. But in terms of Close the Gap and in terms of women, just more broadly, we see really high participation levels from women across a range of our programmes, particularly around entrepreneurship and leadership. So we've been really encouraged by the sort of steps taken to try and encourage the more broader engagement and ensure that our programmes and our means of delivery is really conducive to females participating in accessing these funds.
Thank you. Can I just clarify, you mentioned the £800,000. Is that Highlands and Islands allocation of the Green Jobs Fund to date, or was that other funding?
That's our budget allocated under the Green Jobs Fund for this financial year. We're £1.2 million allocated in subsequent years.
Okay. Doesn't seem like a huge amount. Okay, thank you. And maybe a South of Scotland perspective on that?
Yes, thank you. Thanks for the question and the opportunity to answer. So very much like HAI, we've taken the same approach and we haven't done a call out for funding. Really, in every aspect and opportunity it's presented to us, we're looking for opportunities both for green jobs but also to support a wide range of underrepresented communities and groups. So we have a wide range of examples of where that has been possible, and particularly we're active in terms of securing and supporting women in terms of accessing this area, and that's going to be a real focus going forward. And again, as we develop our strategy regarding women in business and communities, we welcome sharing that with the committee at a future date. We also look at the wider range of underrepresented groups, so particularly in terms of adults with autism and young people and adults with additional needs, so such as Better Lives Partnership in the Usual Place. We've supported them funding in terms of more opportunities in this arena and to broaden their skill set as well. So really looking at from a South of Scotland perspective across all the broad range of underrepresented groups and giving them an equal opportunity in this fund.
Thank you. And just a final question, just a more general question perhaps to Scottish Enterprise. COP26 is just around the corner. What do you see as being the main opportunities for Scotland at COP26 to attract investors?
So, in the context of COP26, thank you for the question. It is a massive opportunity to have the eyes of the world on Scotland. And well, clearly the priority is about the environmental decisions that are made for the future from our collective perspective. Economically, it's an opportunity to do a number of things. The first of those is as the increased awareness of the whole issue of environmental futures is to work with the industry base and company base in Scotland to get more companies thinking about, from their own perspective, what the implications of a net zero transition are for them, how they become more adapted to in terms of their businesses and the things they make and do and the way they do that, to recognise that, to understand what the challenges could be and what the opportunities are of that. The second element of it is obviously while the event is here and as I say, while the eyes of the world are on us, the opportunity to showcase technology and businesses in Scotland. We are collectively, along with colleagues in Scottish Government and local authorities and other partners, and a wide range of industry bodies developing it. We've developed a programme of activities that mirrors the duration of COP and tries to highlight a number of kind of Scotland's key areas of technology and innovation in that space and some of the companies that we have. And we're trying to ensure that we engage the world in that during the time that COP is here. And then beyond that, there's a focus on the legacy that COP then gives us, both the environmental legacy and what that means and the things that we need to do from a policy perspective to continue to achieve our ambitions around our net zero future and net zero targets, but also from an economic development perspective, what that means for companies, what are the opportunities to take new technologies out internationally as well as domestically and apply those and start to really take a future, build on Scotland's position as a key area, which a key country in developing these kind of technologies and sharing them with the world and emphasising the importance that we see in net zero as a core part of the future, but the opportunity in that as well.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. Monica, before I hand over to Liam Kerr, Andy MacDonald, you mentioned a number of like trade events, trade promotion events surrounding COP, which I think is an excellent idea. I wondered if you could share with the committee, to the extent possible, what those events are, what's planned, if it's appropriate coming from Scottish Enterprise, or we could ask the Scottish Government.
I can certainly share the broad intent that there are a number of events mirroring some key areas of activity that we're undertaking in Scotland, the opportunities around things like transport, environment, space, heat, things that are related to the net zero area. These will be a mix of events. Some of them will be audience events, debates, conversations. Some of them will be talking about specific technologies and putting on exhibitions. There will be a mix of live space and meetings and virtual events around those key themes. We are utilising, in partnership with Scottish Government, things like places like the Lighthouse in Glasgow in order to host events, but also then be able to share them as widely as we can in terms of the opportunities, and also opportunities out in amongst other parts of Scotland as well, and linking those into an overall programme. So transport events that will be included in things in Aberdeen and Orkney and in Dundee at the Michelin Scotland Innovation Park, as well as core events around COP in Glasgow and around the Glasgow facilities, other events across Scotland that link into it. So we're trying to build a cohesive programme with industrial partners, with academic partners and with government. So we're showcasing what policy is doing and driving, showcasing the innovation of Scottish companies, but also sharing that as widely as we can and working with people who are coming to Glasgow for COP to try and make sure that there's engagement between some of those world leaders in different companies, different businesses and different technologies, and policymakers as well, with the business and industry base here, alongside programmes that other partners will be running around community engagement and social engagement as well, so that the economic element of that is covered too as part of a broader programme. the broader programme. Clearly, Scottish Government is a better place than we are to talk about, but the economic elements of it is very much a collaboration of our agencies and a number of other industry partners and bodies and academic institutions as well.
OK, well, thank you very much for that update. Let me bring in Liam Kerr, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. It's a question specifically for Scottish Enterprise, perhaps for you and Mearns. Clearly, the North East is going through a transitional time. And in fact, the P&J was reported, the Press and Journal was reporting yesterday that Aberdeen is facing a challenge unlike anything in its history, partly due to the energy transition and the oil and gas downturn. Now, there are those who say that the North East needs a dedicated enterprise agency, which would just be focused solely on the needs of the North East. So what does Scottish Enterprise think of that proposition?
Thank you for the question. So we absolutely understand the issues that are...
I think we temporarily lost Scottish Enterprise there. Perhaps we can move on. Liam, I'm not sure if you had a question, a supplemental question. Oh, hello, Ewan, you're back. Can you hear us?
Yes, I can. Apologies.
That's okay.
For that. So I was saying that we absolutely acknowledge the issues that are facing the northeast of Scotland, along with other regions across Scotland, so we are, you know, delivering a national approach to economic development. But what we're doing is tailoring our support to particular regions. So we're active and working with local authorities and other partners at a regional level to make sure we can support the specific opportunities and issues and challenges that they may be facing. So as we've discussed just earlier in this session, we're very actively involved in supporting the energy transition that Andy talked about. So we're able to work with other agencies in the northeast of Scotland to address some of those opportunities and issues.
Okay, thank you, Liam. Let me bring in Fiona Hislop, please.
Thank you, and good morning, everyone. To Highlands and Islands, I think we acknowledge that not all green jobs have to come from the Green Jobs Fund. And could you confirm my understanding that at the request of High and to secure more flexibility in their general and uplifted budget last year, that you've ensured that you can invest in green jobs and that the majority of the Green Jobs Fund is actually with Scottish Enterprise for that purpose? And for Scottish Enterprise and for South of Scotland, you've all talked about how you support your clients or account managed companies in achieving net zero. But bearing in mind the biggest impact to achieve net zero is going to be heating in buildings and decarbonisations. So what are you doing, or what do you think needs to be done to help SMEs in this area who are not account managed or have access in a regular relationship with SE or SOSE in order to help them achieve investment to decarbonise and for the heating of their buildings? And particularly bearing in mind many of these SMEs will be carrying a lot of debt because of COVID debt in terms of business debt. So I'm concerned whether there's any sort of gap in the market there. But maybe, Hi, if you can confirm that you're investing in green jobs, not just through the Green Jobs Fund, and SE and SOSE, if you can address SMEs that you don't account manage, and how do we help them invest for decarbonisation and to reduce their heating emissions? Hi, please.
Thank you, Ms. Club. Yeah, I mean, just to say that in terms of, we absolutely can confirm that we are investing in creating jobs in using more than just the Green Jobs Fund. And I think that actually reflects the demand that we're seeing, the nature of the projects and the proposals coming forward from our businesses and our communities that were already on this trajectory. We knew that we had that sort of pipeline of demand that we were looking to support and make that as as mainstream. And I think, you know, all that we're trying to do within HIGH just now is really is to mainstream this net zero approach in all of our interventions, whether that be financial or advisory or other means there. So, and also in terms of delivery, as you'll appreciate, that we've been very focused on COVID recovery and over the last year in terms of delivering COVID recovery funds, COVID resilience funds and COVID recovery. So, you know, as we move forward, then what we'll be looking to do is continue to have that heightened engagement with a broader mix of clients or companies and organisations, but also then just to be having that conversation around the nature of the investment that we want to make and to make sure that it is compliant with net zero trajectory.
Thank you. And SE on SMEs that you don't have a relationship with just now, but we need to decarbonise and help in terms of their emissions.
So I can pick that up at the level of decarbonisation in particular. And we have, in a similar fashion to, as Audrey said, following the period of COVID recovery, and we're still clearly engaged in that. We are working with a broad base of companies in any case. A key part of our work in each of the areas that we're focusing on in decarbonisation and transport, heat and energy is about building up the opportunities for the whole supply chain and bringing new companies into that. And as Ewan mentioned earlier on, the net zero framework for action overlays all that we're doing in Scottish Enterprise around those challenges. And specific focus on small and medium companies, we've changed the model that we operate by. So our business support is not done in the old-fashioned as we did around account-managed companies and a particular priority around those. It's very much around opportunity now. So the Green Jobs call that we undertook was an example of that. It wasn't constrained to particular companies that we account-managed. It was open to any companies to apply. And we are setting up our response to be much more focused on, particularly with digital technology, allowing companies to contact us, to enabling a broader range of companies to come to us for support. And the support will be around a specific challenge or a specific issue. So decarbonisation would be one of those. So while we will still have relationships with the companies, it will be with a broader range of companies. It will be more time limited in the sense that it will be responding to immediate challenges and opportunities. And a broader range of input hopefully will allow us to be more focused in the range of service and support that we provide to those companies too.
And thank you. I don't know if you've frozen or we're... Oh.
Okay, it looks like we've lost our panel for the moment. It's probably a good idea for us to suspend at this moment. Okay, welcome back to our panel. Sorry for that technical interruption. I'll hand over to Fiona Hislop.
I don't know if Andy had anything further to say, and then I can move on to South of Scotland. I'm not sure, Andy, were you coming to a close there, or was there anything else?
I was coming to a close. In the context, in the interest of time, I'll allow other colleagues from South of Scotland to step in.
Thank you, Andy.
Thank you for the question, Ms. Hislop. It's interesting. I was on secondment to Scottish Enterprise for 22 months before joining SOSI, and I see the kind of alignment of how we kind of work together. And in SOSI, it's quite different in the fact that we're working, you know, we get business advisors, we get community advisors, so we're working almost all the time as SMEs and micro businesses. That's the kind of general makeup of the regional economy around here. So I think for us, it's very much a belief we have is that we really need to listen closely to the business to find out the sort of level of support they're looking for. We're going to be developing a toolkit, and I know there's a toolkit frenzy everywhere. Lots of people have toolkits, but I think a lot of those have been developed possibly, you know, without working so closely with business. So we are absolutely adamant that we're going to make sure we're working with the businesses in this region to make sure that we can support with the partners we work with the sort of level of interventions they need so that they can benefit from this just transition to net zero. So it's a very, very, very big focus of SOSI. It's absolutely one of my top priorities joining here was to make sure that we could get in working closely with businesses, not just to support them, but to amplify what they're doing. There's certain businesses I've been visiting lately in this region, which are just unbelievable, the things they're doing, the ethical dairy, you know, some of the distilleries. It's fantastic. So there's a huge appetite for businesses. And rather than you know, maybe just saying there's a toolkit here, there's a toolkit there, I want to make sure that we are working closely with those businesses to actually articulate some of the support they need there. And I maybe ask my colleague Claire to jump in with supplementary, because Claire's been here since almost the start of SOSI. She knows about some of the day-to-day dealings that we've had. So Claire, if you wouldn't mind adding some examples perhaps.
Super. Thanks, Martin. And thank you, Mrs. Lutt, for the question. There's some really good and developed work in the south of Scotland, working with the supply chain, particularly the sole traders and SMEs, to understand what opportunities there are in this area for them and actually what are they needing. We are working closely with Developing Scotland's Young Workforce and our colleges, who are understanding and acting and creating bespoke solutions which meet their needs and understand the barriers and challenges they have on a daily basis. So areas, you know, when you've got a single person who can't afford to take time off his work to do the or her work to do the training or the redevelopment, it's really looking about what support and alternative mechanisms we could do. We're developing digital systems. We've got Digital Construction Skills Scotland involved. We're working with the colleges in terms of the green skills agenda and actually how do we take what they're already good at already and offer other opportunities. There's some really good engagement with that, with the Heat and Energy Forum and the Construction Industry Forums that we've got set up, and all partners with CITB and Skills Development Scotland are involved in these discussions, because by working together and using our skill set across all the agencies, we're actually developing solutions which are going to make a difference, respond to the needs going forward and the opportunities going forward. But you know, we're minded that this is difficult and this is challenging, but we're aware of that, and we've made a commitment to work together to find solutions and to work through the hurdles by the, you know, with the opportunities and funding that we can give and the additional support and expert help that we're dialing in to help our small businesses and our communities increase their skill set so that they can respond and deliver on the heat agenda, the decarbonisation agenda, and really make it local and specific. And we're starting to do pilot programmes and pilot projects to lead by example. We've got a key pilot project with the Mountain Bike Innovation Centre, which is an opportunity afforded to us out of the Borderlands Growth Deal to actually set an exemplar way of working that the supply chain will benefit from. And we're in building skills and net zero at the very heart of this, so that we're starting on the right foot and we can monitor and track its progress. And again, it's something else we'd welcome bringing back to a committee at a future date to show you what can be done when we work differently and work together.
Thank you.
Thanks very much, Fiona. Mark Ruskell has a brief supplemental.
Yeah, just on that, can you just give us some clarity that you are able to work across sectors, so you're not exclusively working within the private sector, you are able to work with public companies, with social enterprises, and I'm kind of struck with the heat sector, for example. You know, we've got some great examples of sort of public companies that are delivering heat, like Aberdeen Heat and Power, for example. I know councils are interested in that space of delivering heat networks, delivering local heat to communities. But you know, can they get kind of support from enterprise companies to do that, or are there restrictions in terms of the remits that you have? Are you working across sector? Not sure who wants to go on that.
I could certainly have an initial response if that's okay. Thank you for that question. That's really probing. So yes, we're very keen to make sure that there's not artificial boundaries which would inhibit anything. And to do that, certainly the local authorities in the south of Scotland and Breeze and Galloway and Scottish Borders are very active in terms of the heat agenda and decarbonisation. And we're working closely with the RSLs, the Registered Social Landlords, as well, because there's a key aspect here in terms of the supply chain for affordable housing. And the other important item for all of us is around the poverty agenda, because this is another way of helping people with less affordable incomes and means to actually make sure that they're not in fuel poverty. So we see this as a really important agenda, and certainly we're seeing cross sectors, cross areas working, because that's what's going to create the new and innovative solutions, and having communities embedded at that, because they know what they need and want and what's right for their community. So really having that cross economic, environmental and social approach to these wicked issues and problems are giving us new ways to create solutions and to create bespoke systems at which we're starting to put in place. So yes, I would very much see cross-sector working as key.
Anyone else? Andy?
And yes, I would echo Claire's view that nowadays we are working with across a broad range of partners in order to ensure that we address the challenges, particularly around climate, but more broadly as well, economically. So working with third sector organisations, social organisations, very much to an increased extent over the years that I've been involved in economic development, through local authorities as well, with partners there, and the regional in place dimension is hugely important to the economic development work that we're doing now as well. So working closely in local partnerships as well as at a national level and across a number of these issues, recognising where the solutions lie.
Okay. Thanks very much, Mark. Colette Stevenson has a brief supplemental.
Yeah, it was just based on what Ms Hislop asked you about supporting SMEs and sole traders going forward. It was just to see, for each of the enterprises, where do you see the role of Business Gateway, the 19 Business Gateways, in supporting SMEs as well and sole traders? And how joined up is it, you know, are each of the enterprises and working with the Business Gateways in order to support just transition and net zero as well? I'm sorry, if I could go to Scottish Enterprise on that.
I'm happy to do. We're very much still involved in broad partnership with and the Business Gateways are critical to that in terms of delivery through the business support partnerships that we've been working on, and that came together very rapidly in the response to COVID, and bringing together the various areas of support and bringing together all the partners who could provide support to companies. But the Business Gateways have long been and continue to be a critical part of the route to engagement with businesses. It's about the right resource to support the right questions for the right businesses, and working very much in partnership across that. So the best place for support for an individual business will be in one of the agencies, and there's a single door of entry, a single point of entry through the business support partnership, and then the right support will be brought to that business.
Thank you. Can I ask the South of Scotland Enterprise that question as well?
Thank you, Ms Stevenson. Welcome answering that question. So in terms of that Business Gateway aspect, that is really important, and it's important about creating that one-stop shop, that customer journey, so that any business that comes to seek any of the agencies for advice and support, it's a smoothness and they're getting to the point of entry that they need to be at. With respect to the model in the South of Scotland, we are actively delivering Business Gateway on behalf of Scottish Borders and working really closely. Business Gateway through Dumfries and Galloway is delivered through Business Dumfries and Galloway Council. But again, we work very closely with our Dumfries and Galloway Council colleagues, because it's really important, you know, as I said, that we have a seamless experience. It's a customer journey is really important here. So any business that approaches us, regardless of the point of entry, should get the same experience and get to the point. So the South of Scotland approach is to really work very closely with Business Gateway, so that the end user is getting a seamless experience, and it's almost regardless of who's delivering that service, they get what they need at the right time to really give them the opportunities to respond to the agendas around heat and decarbonisation. And we're working closely together in the background with the councils, but also the other agencies which are relevant here, like Skills Development Scotland, Development Scotland's Young Workforce. There's so many opportunities, and that the more conversations we have and the more we join up our systems and procedures, the better experience the business and the customer.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks, Colette. And a very brief final question from me. Colette Stevenson asked a very good question about how the agencies work with Business Gateway. My question is, how do the agencies work with the Scottish National Investment Bank, who we heard from earlier this morning? The bank works together with the agencies to originate investment opportunities, but we heard from the bank that it's creating its own origination team. So I wondered if the agencies could give us a very brief view as to how that origination function might look in the future. Do you still see the agencies having an origination role, or over time would that perhaps be something that the bank assumes and takes over? Perhaps I could ask Scottish Enterprise first. Ewan, is that
maybe
something?
I can...
Yeah.
Maybe I'll make a start. So I'm looking at Andy here, wondering who's going to take a lead. So we do clearly work very closely with the Scottish National Investment Bank. I think we heard earlier in the earlier session about referrals very much, you know, Scottish Enterprise is focused on supporting early stage investment. We have programmes which help businesses to grow into new markets, particularly in terms of net zero related opportunities. And as part of that, we're working with the investment community, which is includes the Scottish National Investment Bank as well as co-investors. So, we are focused on that early stage investment. But when businesses scale and grow, then perhaps the scale of that investment may be more relevant for the bank. I don't know if Andy wants to come in on that as well.
Yeah, I'm happy to. The detailed answer to that question really lies with our colleagues in the growth investment part of Scottish Enterprise. We're engaged in the direct discussions with the National Investment Bank on where the transition happens. But very much as you're saying, we still have a very strong role in early stage business development and the investment community that goes, the investments that go around that, and our growth investment team. Is still a very active part of our support for businesses and the delivery that my teams do, for example, in our areas of activity are very much aligned with, and the growth investment team aligns with us as well in terms of where those opportunities are to invest in technologies and in businesses. And we've developed over the years along with colleagues in High ahead of the development of SOSI. In the Energy Investment Fund, for example, which was previously the Renewable Energy Investment Fund, and has supported a lot of projects and technologies, both technology development in energy, new renewable energy technologies, but also in supporting community projects to embed those and deliver those. And that's a function which has been a significant part of the development of company base and industry base, as well as community projects. Over the years, particularly in conjunction, as I say, with High, and we're in discussion just now with Scottish Government and with the National Investment Bank on how those types of activities will happen, but also in the broader question of where the transition of business development happens and business growth as businesses scale up and come into the remit of the National Investment Bank, as opposed to the growth investment function that we have in Scottish Enterprise and in the other economic development agencies as well.
Okay, well, look, thank you very much for that response. I appreciate we're running slightly beyond our allocated time. So that brings an end to the questions we have for our panel this morning. Thank you once again for joining us and for providing an update on your respective agencies' plans. And enjoy the rest of your day. That brings an end to the public session. Thank you.